Welcome to the series where we're going to take you on a journey to be more self-sufficient.
What more do you want?
As I'm going to rekindle our passion for easy-to-follow DIY.
Perfect.
We'll be looking back at the TV archives to rediscover the very best homes and gardens advice.
Aerate the soil of the area that you're going to re-turf.
From some of the nation's favourite experts.
The potatoes in the ground have been very successful.
Showing you how, even with limited tools...
Who's first for the sausages, then?
..we can all master the basic skills. Now, that is solid. Everything from upcycling...
We're going to have fun.
..quick fixes...
You see how easy it comes off?
..right through to the builds that we all need to know.
There's really not a lot to it.
Plus, in my workshop... I'll be sharing my simple home hacks.
It works a treat.
And demos to get everybody started. If you can pinch an inch, you've done it too loose. Inspiring you to do it all yourself. Saving you money and finally tackling those everyday jobs together. Job done and dusted. Welcome to our first show. And as you can see, there are loads of handy tips and clever ways to make the most out of what you've got lying around the house. Now, don't worry, if you're not a pro DIY or this is your first time to it, we're all going to learn some great things along the way. And I think we're going to make some blinding stuff as well. Today, we're going to learn how to grow your own food.
I mean, what more could you ask from a crop?
And some amazing hacks.
It works a treat.
We're going to be learning how to fix a leaking tap.
So what are we going to do with it? Well, I'll tell you what we're going to do with it. We're going to... throw it away.
And lay down your own floor.
Yeah, nothing.
And I'm going to be making some home projects that you can all do yourself.
Look at that.
Now that is neat. First up, Sarah, who's going to show us how to recycle some old jars into something so useful, you're going to want to see this one.
Well, at first sight, they might not look much to you, but I think these are absolutely beautiful, and they literally don't make them like this anymore. I would love to turn them into lighting, but I think the first thing I need to do is give them a really good scrub down and see exactly what I'm dealing with.
Lighting? Will light be able to penetrate all that dirt? Time for a bath.
I'm not sure I'd want my marmalade in them.
The rusty lids have left marks on the glass. But Sarah's happy to keep it for a bit of added character.
And quite a good nick, actually. Look at them.
With the jars rinsed and dried, Sarah assembles her light-making kit.
So I've got these great aged bronze fittings here. I've got some flex, which is covered in natural linen, and a wiring job.
To prevent the flex from unravelling, Sarah is covering each end with insulation tape. After stripping back the plastic jacket on each wire, she is carefully screwing the cables into the bulb holder.
So it's really important to make sure that these are in just the right places. The earth goes in the middle, and then you've got the live and the neutral on either side.
The top cap then clips into the bulb holder, ready for the main fitting to be screwed in.
Really good fit. So I just want to suspend this light fitting just inside the jar. So I've got this. Now, these you can buy to turn your jars into lovely posy holders. Now, this is made of metal, and I know that metal and flex don't go well together, so I just need to insulate the cable to make sure that when it goes through here, it can't fray on the metal. These are Libby's drinking glasses, and I'm sure she's not going to miss just a tiny bit off the end of each one.
That extra layer of insulation reduces the risk of the flex being worn down by the metal lid. Bramble's intrigued.
Do you like it? Not interested.
Sarah's handiwork failed that inspection, but it will be examined and pat tested by a qualified electrician before it's finished.
So that's the wiring done. Now the fun bit, because I want to paint on these jars. My plan is to use a frosting spray so that they have a lovely glow when the light's turned on, and then use a palette of botanical colours to paint some really sophisticated designs on them. Frosting first.
The golden rule of working with aerosol paint is shake the can vigorously. And, of course, when working with any aerosol product, always do so in a well-ventilated area. As Sarah wants a clear window through the frosted glass, she's masked off a section using sticky labels.
Hope that's a desirable effect.
We hope so too, Sarah. For the finishing touch, Sarah is painting patterns onto the frosted surface.
This is going to take ages.
Sarah's challenge was to turn a very unappealing collection of old jars into a set of charming and sellable desk lights. Would you believe it? The frosted glass diffuses the light beautifully. And Sarah's delicately painted botanic motifs add colour and country garden charm to this elegant makeover. The clear window makes a feature of the retro-style LED bulbs, even when the light is switched off.
Well, the lights are working, and I think the project's working too, because they've been frosted, they've been painted, they've been tested, and now they're ready to go. And I'm hoping with all the botanical influences that this lot should fit right into somebody's home.
So that was easy. It just goes to show that you can recycle almost anything. And you don't need to stop at jars. You can use vases, bottles, anything, as long as you're getting creative and having fun. Remember, folks, if you're doing anything electrical, call a qualified electrician. Don't do anything that makes you feel uncomfortable. Leave that to the professionals. Creating your own garden or growing your own veg is a fun thing to do, and there are loads of ways to do it. But Monty shows us exactly how to do it simply, even if you haven't done it before.
All our vegetables here at Berryfields are grown in raised beds, which means that the soil is mounded up, so you have a depth of soil above the normal ground height, contained with boards. Now, it doesn't matter what you use to contain it, because the point is to keep that soil from spilling onto the paths. And the advantage of a raised bed is that you never need to tread on it. That way the soil doesn't get compacted, so the roots get a really good root run, and it's a very efficient and effective way of growing vegetables. And you can make a raised bed really easily, big enough, to give yourself a fresh salad every day of the year. And it just needs to be about a metre long. So even if you've got a tiny garden, a small raised bed will give you the start you need for your own homegrown veg. Now, I've used here old scaffolding boards, but any boards will do, as long as they're at least 6 inches high, and I tend not to like using tannelized timber because the chemicals can get into the vegetables. And by attaching two sides to there, I'm going to screw the ends on to make a box. Now, you could use nails just as well, but the beauty of a screw is that you can unscrew it very easily. And nowadays, with battery-operated screwdrivers, that goes straight in there. And we'll put one in this end to hold it. Now, I can tell you, I'm one of the world's most cack-handed DIYers. So if I can do this, then anybody can. There we go. And there we have a box. And that will work perfectly well over lawn or gravel, because the grass won't grow through the soil. What I'm going to add here is just a peg in each corner to hold it in place. I'll just put a couple in to give you the idea. Bang that down or saw off the top when it's insecurely, and in fact, if you add a screw or a nail to that, that keeps it really rigid. It's not going to go anywhere. We have the box on the ground. It's just like a container with an open bottom, really, and then fill it with soil. Now, all vegetables grow best in rich soil. That really is quite important. So I've got some Berryfields compost to go in the bottom. Put a layer in like that, because we need good, rich soil for these vegetables that have got to do an awful lot of work growing in a short amount of time. Then on top of that, good topsoil, and then we'll also put another layer of compost on the top. Of course, the purpose of all this work, of preparing yourself a plot, and actually, when you think about it, that's what this is a vegetable plot, however small it might be, is that you get a really good harvest. Remember, growing vegetables is all about eating more than about gardening.
Now, that was simple and easy. All you needed was a hammer and some screws. That was it. Now, if you want to downsize this and bring it inside, you're going to need a base. Put some plastic on top of it so the wood doesn't get rotten. If you don't have any wood lying around, get down to your timber yard or buy some online. Loads of us are working from home nowadays, and finding a desk that fits the right size might be tricky and expensive. But I'm going to show you a way to make your own one that is cost-effective and beautiful. Let's go! So all you need is some timber, spirit level, screws and a drill. This timber that I've got is offcuts from jobs that I've done before, but you can go to your timber yard and you can get them to cut out exactly what you need. I'm going to use these as brackets, but you can just buy a bracket. But rather than throw these away, I thought I'd use them up. So this one gets drilled against the wall. This one sits on top, like that. And then this supporting bracket goes right in there. And that just holds it all together. So here, I've got my wall. Really, it's the back of my desk. As I tap along there, I'm listening for where it is solid. Sound is hollow. When I tap here, it's more dull. And what that means is there's a stud. There's one of these running down the back of it. Or you've got a joist running down the back there, and that's what you should be screwing into. So I've got some lovely wood screws here, and these will go through timber and just give me that secure hold. One tip, it's the pre-drill. So you can just see it just poking out there. So what you've got to do is straighten up your timber and make sure you use your spirit level. And the bubble's got to be in the middle. And if it is, what we say in the trade is it bubble? And it is. Look at that. Bang on. Once it's straight, drill away. Just check. So I've screwed it in, but I haven't gone all the way in. And basically, that's just to make sure it's bang on. And then drill it all the way home. Look at that. That by itself is not coming out. Oh, that's there for good. So, whatever I put on top of it, it's gonna hold it solid. And as I said before, pre-drill. Come along when we carry the load to every road in country code safe. Now that is good, but we do need the bracket because the further you come out here, it starts to pull on that side. So, once we've got the bracket in play, that will hold it nice and secure. We just got to check, is that bubble? Wherever you're screwing, you can put wood glue. So, you could put wood glue there or underneath where I drilled, but that's really solid, doesn't really need it. There might be a little gap there. Don't worry about it. This is what you're after. A nice, solid grip. And that is secure. So if we put our desk on it, now that is solid. And I know it's only one bracket, but you can tell if you repeat the process on the other side, you're gonna get the same result. So now I've got these two drilled together. I need to put this one into where the joist is there. But how do I know that's the same height as that one? What you could do is get a little bit of timber, something flat and straight, get your spirit level, move it up or down. Nice. And this is where you might need an extra pair of hands. So if you've got someone to help you, brilliant. If not, you could see that I'm doing it a bit by myself. Always check. That's good. That's still good. And we want to check the upright. On a spirit level, you've got the horizontal for doing that, and then you've got the vertical there. So I'll put that against there to make sure that that is bubble as well. Now that is secure. So all I have to do is put my floating desk on. Now that is good. You could screw this down secure it to the actual brackets, but make sure the screws are countersunk so they don't sit proud on top of the desk. So you can either leave a gap at the back so all your cables can come up so you can plug in your computer, or you can drill some holes along there, right where your computer's gonna go, and that's where your wires come up. Now that is neat.
One more time, break it down.
As working from home becomes even more popular and sometimes necessary, these space-saving tips will always be useful. If you want to make the most of things you have lying around the house, as I always say, get creative. Up next, you'll see that with a bit of inspired thinking, you can turn something that's dull into something that shines and has true personality.
Has got a bit to do, hasn't it?
Yeah, vanity. It's a real problem for me. No, we whip that mirror off the bottom,
yes.
But we're leaving the one on the top, and we're going to try and make a little starlet kind of lights around for the pop diva that she is.
Theatre, yeah.
Very much. I wouldn't know, would I, Lovey? So what we're going to do is a surround, which is just going to edge the mirror all the way around there, because the edges are quite rough on it, and overlap it, so it's going to be about 6 inches thick, like so. And it's going to come out from the wall. Then on the inside of it, we're going to put loads of lights in there, so it's going to look like the old Hollywood-style makeup mirror. And we're just going to paint it up so it matches the room. The mirror's going to be sat there in the middle of it, and all the lights around the outside. Probably put a switch down here at the bottom or something, just so it's switched independently, so it doesn't come on with the rest of the lights in the room. This is what the box is going to look like. Just stand it upright. It's quite heavy, but it's going to go like that. The mirror is going to be on the inside of it, and we're going to have all these rather flashy light fittings fitted to the inside as well, so it is just going to look like a mirror, like you'd see in the old musicals and things like that, when you go into the dressing rooms of the starlets. You'd have these, all the light bulbs all the way around. To make the box, I've just used a nail gun, an MDF, 18mm MDF, glued it, nailed it all together. This brown stuff on the front here is filler. It's a two-pack filler, so it's a filler with a hardener that you add to it. I've gone around and filled all the holes, so I've got quite a bit of sanding to do. And also I've got some holes to drill as well, where all my cable's gonna access the back of the light fittings. So still a lot of work to do yet. I'm just starting to wire up now the light. This is quite a bit of work because of the amount of lights we've got on it. But basically we're using ceiling roses, because this is the safest form of doing it, because you've got all your terminals, earth terminal, live and neutral. And we're mounting these all the way around the inside of the big U shape, which is going to be fitted around the mirror. And then we've got these rather attractive pygmy light bulbs, which are just going to be popped in like so. So it'll look like a makeup mirror. To connect it up, we're just using flex, wiring in between the lights. And we've got a light switch just on the top there, so it's independently switched from the lights in the rest of the room. And we've just got two more to go, then it can go upstairs and be fitted. Resting on the batten at the top, and we've got some mirror brackets which are just down the side here. We're just going to screw them back as well. Just needs to move that way a fraction. See those right in the gap there. Get a screwdriver in. One either side there. Pop the other one in. It's a bit tight in here. And then we've got a couple of screws to go in the top, which I'll just put in a second. Moment of truth. Fantastic, just like Broadway.
Lights look really effective. It's very sort of Hollywood glamour, isn't it?
I know, it all kind of goes together. I mean, when we had the bits out here on the lawn, you couldn't see how it was going to gel together. But now it's all in, it looks like a finished article. And as you say, quite a bit of work gone into it, but quite a bit of fun as well.
Now that's a perfect look, especially for the kids. Now if you don't want to add bulbs, you can just add a frame around the mirror and that's it. Even nowadays, you can get some LED lights. They won't cost you an arm and a leg. And I'll tell you what, they even flash as well, different colors. I've always wanted to grow my own vegetables, and I tell you, I'm a bit scared of doing it. But hopefully in this next clip, Carol will show me exactly how to do it right.
French beans, broad beans, bolotti beans, tall peas, dwarf peas, petit pois and mange tout. They all belong to the same family, the legumes. They're amongst the most popular of homegrown vegetables, and they're so easy to grow. As well as being outstandingly beautiful and so, so bountiful, they also benefit the soil. They fix nitrogen on their roots. So when you take them out, the soil's even better than when they went in. I mean, what more could you ask from a crop? The thing about peas and beans is that what we eat is also the plant seed, or its seed pods.
This is not just a bean, this is food. It's food that can be stored and kept over and passed from generation to generation. There's just something so beautiful about them.
At this time of year, when the ground's cold and there's still chance of a frost or two, you can sow your first lot of peas under glass for an early June harvest. As an alternative to pots, you can sow peas into lengths of plastic guttering.
And I'm going to make it to measure, exactly. Custom made for this bed. And I'm going to cut it with a hacksaw, she said confidently. The reason you sow your peas into guttering is so that they're off to a really flying start. So by the time you put them out, they should be sturdy little plants of 3 or 4 inches high. And you slide them off this guttering into a little sort of prepared trench. And they hardly know they've been moved. Well, these are an Italian variety. They're called Piccolo Provenzale. They're very, very full pods of sweet, tender peas. And this is a real sort of delicacy of a pea, I think. You ought to treat all your vegetables as a delicacy, something special. Ooh, my little peas. Hope the mice don't get these. I'm so looking forward to eating them.
Now the weather's a bit warmer, I can start sowing directly into the soil.
I'm going to sow the first of my peas outside here. And I've got this great big long bed that I can use just for them, which is quite a luxury. But I'm going to sow them successionally. I'm going to sow this block now, and I think I'll get about 6 successional sowings right the way along the beds. So I can carry on from May right the way through to July sowing peas, and I can eat them from July onwards, right the way through into the autumn. I'm sowing a pea called Hurst Green Shaft. It's got very long pods and really sweet peas, and I'm going to put them in 2 inches apart, both ways, and just plant them on a sort of grid. I'm going to use an old ruse, which is to put holly all across this patch. You could use anything prickly, you know, you could use the stuff that you pruned off your berberis, anything which is just a physical barrier to just keep those little critters off your peas.
Now that was amazing and simple. I don't know why I was worrying. You can get a metre of guttering for under a tenner. Now laying down that holly, now that is genius. We'll be back later to see how Carol gets on. Now, I know this is a problem that many of us must have come across before, and it is super frustrating. It's a leaky tap. But before you call out an expensive plumber, there is a simple way that you can check and see if you can fix it yourself.
We have a problem with a leaky tap. The problem is inevitably going to be in here. Now, under there is a little washer that will be worn and old and tired, and it simply needs replacing. It really is a dead simple job. First thing I need to do, though, is to go and turn off the water. And that's the water off. What I now need to do is just gently remove this little covering cap here. And I just need to unscrew the actual tap handle itself. And obviously, every tap's going to be different, so they all work on the basic same principle, but they're all going to be slightly different. That just needs to come off like so. Next, this usually unscrews, but this particular one just pops off. That's just a covering cap. Next little job is to get a spanner and remove this nut. So just supporting the tap and easing off that nut. Dead simple. And you may actually see a wee bit of water coming out at this point, but don't panic. It's only the water that's left in the pipe. This has to come off now. This is the offending article. You can see this washer has quite frankly seen better days. So what are we going to do with it? Well, I'll tell you what we're going to do with it. We're going to throw it away. Simple as that, because washers are two a penny. I've bought some new ones here. And it's just a simple case of popping a new one on, just a little bit of brute force, and there you go. That just slots back in there. Screw it down finger tight, back on with the spanner. There cannot be an easier DIY job. Just nip it up. On goes the covering cap, like that. Push that down. On goes the handle yet again. Screw it up with your screwdriver. And I'm just going to turn the water on and make sure that we've solved our little problem. And the moment of truth has arrived. The big question is, does it work? Well, there's a couple of little drips there and one there, but fundamentally, that's the job done. So I can now go and have my cup of tea in peace.
Now, if you've got the older style taps, this will work perfectly, but tap technology has definitely moved on. So check your tap manufacturer's instructions or call an expert. Like Russell said, if anything involves water, find your stopcock and turn it off. You don't want to flood the house, do you? As well as showing you some great home projects, I'm going to be learning and sharing some super useful home hacks. And right now, I'm going to make my very own fridge cleaner. It's going to have no chemicals and it's going to smell gorgeous. And all you need is a jug, some water, apple cider vinegar, and that smells quite strong, and some natural oils. These will give it a sweet smell. And I'm going to go for peppermint in this one. Oh, that smells nice. So, you need a cup of water, which is roughly just under 250 mil.
Go.
Cool. So you need a cup of that, and then you need a cup of apple cider vinegar. Cool. And then, to get rid of the vinegary smell, you need 10, I normally go for 20, drops peppermint in there. And then I'm going to put this into a container. Now, I've got a spray container. If you've got one that you've recycled or you've used before, just wash it out and then get to use this one. So you pour all of that into there. And that does smell nice. And put the lid back on. Make sure it's nice and tight. Give it a good old shake, and then you've got one cleaner. Now, what my mum used to say to me is the taste or the proof is in the pudding. The taste is in the pudding. I'm just hungry, that's all it is. But the proof is in the pudding. Now I've got to test it out. And I've got my little fridge. Here he is. It's my little workshop fridge. The other day I looked in there and it is a bit dirty. So, mum, apologies. Have a look at this. Oh, there we go. Get out of that point. Today's the day that it's going to get cleaned.
It works a treat.
Woo!
Look at that, nice and clean. But remember, it's not antibacterial. But cleaning your fridge is one thing. How about cleaning your floor before you've even laid it?
Julie and Richard need a massive 80 metres of flooring. Meredith is on a mission to find a cheap solution which adds some quality to their bodged-up home. He's brought them to a derelict school and has a radical strategy for finding some high-quality materials.
Is this looking promising for you?
It's looking very exciting.
Yeah, it's amazing, yeah.
I think the issue we've got now is budget for the flooring. Because
and what are you looking at using at the moment?
We wanted to use some kind of probably wood effect.
No, wood effect.
Quality stick down vinyl flooring.
And how much is
that? But
that
would
custom?
Be thousands anyway because of the amount of space we're looking at and we just don't have that money now. So,
it's thousands of pounds for wood effect. Demolition sites are exciting because you're seeing, like a magpie, what you can take out of a place. This is all going to be skipped, basically. And inside there, there's some fantastic material that I'm sure we can find use for in Richard and Julie's house.
Most demolition sites aren't open to the public, so another way you can find salvage materials is to look out for local houses being refurbished.
Wow, so, look at this.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my
Remember
word.
Your old school hall?
I do, I do.
Wow.
Crikey.
Nice floor.
It's like a proper dance floor, isn't it?
Yeah, there we go.
Good, now we can dance.
No, because you're a dab hand at that, aren't you?
We met dancing.
I haven't done it for a few years.
Oh, my goodness.
I've never done it in safety shoes.
You definitely need this floor in your
we
house.
We do need this floor.
Fabulous.
Perfect. Fantastic.
Was this similar to the fake one that you were thinking of having?
It's better, because it's
real.
Oh,
miles better.
So this is pretty solid stuff. These are all tongue and groove, so yeah, I think they'll be able to go back down pretty well.
The wood looks great, but how on earth would we get all that stuff off the back? We wouldn't be able to lay it like that, would we?
And obviously this old bitumen, that needs to come off. Now, well, there is a bit of work to clean them up, but, you know, this stuff's free. You know, if they can get these materials and they make such a big impact, it's going to transform the house.
This vintage parquet is a staggeringly good find, but they'll need to put in time and effort to clean it up. Richard begins hand-cleaning the old bitumen from the tiles. It's a great cost-saving move, but is a monumental task.
When I first started doing these, I could do 20 in an hour. So I cut down on the amount of cleaning I did and managed to get it... I've got it up to 40 in an hour.
Richard is a real perfectionist. He wants to be able to do things in his own time, in his own way. At the end of the day, it's worth it. It's definitely worth it. He does a good job.
Having hand-cleaned all the blocks, his next challenge is to fit them.
Right, let's get this open. Mm. If anyone's got any advice, feel free to chip in.
Richard's using a special parquet flooring adhesive to glue the pieces in place, but he's never attempted anything like this before.
Right, here's nothing. Scary stuff. Right, now then.
It's a race against time to get them in the correct position.
This stuff's meant to dry in about 20 minutes, so you want to make sure you put it in the right place.
Richard's laying the floor from the centre of the room and then working outwards.
Marked this out last night and made sure that it's going straight across the room rather than... if you, like you say, if you start in the corner, you'll probably end up with it looking a bit funny. It's all a bit of a toss-up because you're going to have parts of it that are going to be awkward anyway, whatever way you do it, I think.
Richard and Julie have worked tirelessly for months to get Meredith's vision, but will all the effort be worth it?
So nine tiles down so far, only another, what, 15, 1600 to go?
Yeah, 1600 for this room.
You've done the floor.
Yeah.
Look at that. Was that... That must have been hard, Richard.
There was a lot of effort, time, most of it cleaning them.
Richard spent 40 hours cleaning the bitumen off the bottom tiles.
That's a lot of work.
Yes. Yeah. What do you think of the effect?
I mean, absolutely worth it. We love it.
But the main thing, isn't it, that it just adds a kind of layer of history, of weight, yeah. of authenticity, of real materials. Yeah. It's lovely the way these different colours come up in.
I think it looks beautiful. Oh,
great, yeah.
The only costs? For transportation and adhesive, just £300.
It's a priceless four for £300.
Now, all that hard work has paid off. Chris doesn't even have any experience, and he pulled it off. Now, remember, you've got to put the graft in, but also labour costs money. So where you can, do it yourself. Next up, I'm going to be showing you a handy tip on how to modernise and upholster an old stool. Are you going to make it happen today? Or will you just settle for another delay? Come on. So, this little stool here looks a bit tired, and the seat has no cover. And basically, what we have to do is put fabric on there. You've got to do it the right way to make sure it's nice and tight and secure. But this is what I really want to show you guys how to do. This is really, really simple. I do recommend you getting some new foam, and you can get some online. Just measure out the shape, order it, and then it will come in the post. So, the thing we need is fabric, and I've got... This is lovely. But you need a fabric that is big enough to cover your seat. So make sure you always measure the fabric and measure your seat to be really sure that it covers it. And I'm just going to pull it over, and it is miles too big, but all of that I'm going to cut off after. It's better to have more rather than less. I've got quite a big staple gun, and it's got a compressor underneath my bench, but you don't need something this big. Just a hand staple will do it. One of those heavy-duty ones that you can get from the craft store, perfect. Or you could lose little tacks. If you've got any tacks, no problem. So, first one. So we've gone 1, 2, 3. The best method is to staple at the top, then do the opposite side. Do that side, then do that side. It's basically stretching the material out. If you can pinch an inch, you've done it too loose. And basically, that way, I can't pinch an inch, and that's perfect. Just pull it like that. And then we go to the opposite side. Looks quite secure to me. Let's do the corners now, and just bring the material over. So that is kind of poking out. And then I just want to staple right towards that. So it's a bit of an angle, like that. Gonna go to the opposite corner now. Smooth the fabric out. I want to staple in that kind of angle. But you're gonna be at the same angle as the corner, and that's perfect. As I've made my mark there, I can put the gun right onto it. And it's slightly off, but it's okay. The two corners are done. I can't get any material out. It's impossible. So I do the corners, and then you just staple all along. So, as you can see there already, there's quite a lot of bulk. And if it's to go into a frame that has a very small rebate, the problem is it's going to sit very proud. So, your best bet is to cut off the fabric that you do not see or you do not want. Fold it over, staple. And that, that brings pleasure to me, that does. Just having that nice and flush is absolutely perfect. And cut all that off, and we go to the opposite side. Another thing you have to be mindful of is this. As you fold it, what happens is just here, you could sometimes staple the bit that you want to cut off. So make sure you feel where it starts, and it starts about here. So I would staple up to there, and then stop, cut it, and then continue on. That's the two sides done. That's not very pretty just yet, but soon, once I've done that one, that should be looking good. So there we have it. simple, nice and tight, and it's absolutely perfect. And it sits in as snug as a bug in a rug. And if you want to go one step further, you could paint it a bit like this. It's entirely up to you. Look at that. Now from something soft and comfy to something hard and prickly. It's time to see if Carol's trick of laying the holly down has worked to keep the critters away.
Oh, they're up. Look at this. Wonderful. It's just 2 weeks ago since these were sown, and they've already not just germinated, but they're pushing out of the ground. And this holly's done the trick. I don't think one has been taken. They're really thick and wonderful. And of course, now that they're up, I can sow my next group a little bit further down this row. Just fabulous. These are the very first of our beans. But look at the flowers on them, they're absolutely dripping. I reckon we're going to be picking these right through till the end of October. They're so heavy, they're almost bending the stems down. I've really been looking forward to this, harvesting these first broad beans. The pods are fat and succulent and lovely. Sometimes you get a surprise though, because they look wonderful and you open them up and there's nothing inside except that lovely fluffy lining. But I know for sure these are here and I'm going to harvest them. Those ones that we've actually put in before out of the guttering,
yeah.
I've already picked those. And we had, me and your dad had some pea soup.
Was it nice?
It was lovely, but we've frozen a few of them. The very best way to eat a pea is straight out of the pod. Choose a nice tender one. But so sweet.
Really sweet and crunchy.
Aren't they? Especially when they're young. What's your favourite way of eating peas?
Anything with mint, maybe risotto.
Have you had that?
Yeah.
Sounds delicious.
It's good.
Do you want to cook it for us?
Yeah, maybe.
Now that looks tasty, and I never knew it was so easy. But remember, you don't need a garden to grow your own vegetables. All you need is a pot, and you can plant anywhere. Could be a balcony, it could be your window ledge. Also, you're gonna need some water, and maybe some sunlight. That's it for now. I hope you've enjoyed all the different ways of learning how to fix, upcycle, repair, and revitalise items in your home. Remember, stay creative and have fun.